So welcome to my presentation. So my name is Karol Kaiser, and it's with a great honor for me to have this unique opportunity to present my recent research, which I have done as a PhD student in the lab of Vitezslav Bryja at Masaryk University in great collaboration with the lab of Maria Lehtinen in Boston Children's Hospital. So today I would like to present our findings regarding a novel MACE1-Wnt5a signaling axis and its role in the embryonic development of the choroid plexuses. So Wnt pathway represents an evolutionary conserved signaling pathway that is involved in fundamental biological processes, including morphogenesis, homeostasis, establishment of cell polarity and symmetry breaking, and is also an underlying cause of numerous pathological conditions such as cancer. So based on the activated downstream effectors and outcomes of Wnt signaling, we distinguish Wnt canonical pathway characterized by beta-catenin mediated induction of target genes' transcription. On the other hand, there are also beta-catenin independent non-canonical branches of Wnt signaling, including Wnt planar polarity pathway known as Wnt PCP or Wnt calcium pathway. So as the Wnt5a will play a central role today, I would like to briefly describe this ligand. So Wnt5a is a prototypical non-canonical ligand. And one of the key features of this ligand is its role as a central regulator of morphogenesis and structure outgrowth across the animal kingdom. And as a good example is a developing mouse embryo where a loss of Wnt5a can lead to, for example, shortening of the snout, various craniofacial defects or hypomorphism of limbs. So as you could guess from the title of the talk, another important protagonist of the story today is MACE1 protein. MACE1 protein is a member of MACE factors that belong to the so-called tail proteins, which represent important transcriptional coactivators. And MACE proteins are especially important for the regulation of Hox genes, which represent the key developmentally preserved family of genes involved in the body axis patterning from Drosophila to humans. Another important piece of the puzzle today is the choroid plexus. So to introduce it, I will first mention that the central nervous system contains a network of cavernous spaces called ventricles that contain cerebrospinal fluid. And on this schematic picture, you can see sagittal section of the mouse embryonic brain, where you can distinguish lateral ventricle containing the lateral ventricle choroid plexus. Then there is the third ventricle with the third ventricle plexus. And finally, the most caudally located fourth ventricle containing the fourth ventricle choroid plexus. And I hope that you can also appreciate the nice morphological diversity of these different plexuses. Here you can see a simplified depiction of key structural features of the choroid plexus tissue, which consists of the polarized epithelial monolayer facing the cerebrospinal fluid. And this epithelium encapsulates richly vascularized stromal space containing various cells of mesenchymal origin. So choroid plexus represents a versatile organ central to the proper function of central nervous system as a major site for the production of cerebrospinal fluid. Furthermore, due to the unique properties of its epithelium, choroid plexus also establishes important CNS blood interface, serving as a cerebrospinal blood barrier. Choroid plexus also shapes CNS function by releasing a wide array of biologically active compounds. And it should be also noticed that choroid plexus plays important function in the immunosurveillance of the central nervous system. So now I would like to jump to the results part of today's presentation. So it all started when we noticed that the Wnt5a is selectively expressed in the fourth ventricle choroid plexus and is completely absent from the lateral ventricle choroid plexus. And this pattern also persists at the protein level in the tissue. Moreover, we also notice an interesting distribution pattern of Wnt5a within the choroid plexus epithelium, where Wnt5a can be located in both apical and basolateral side of the epithelium, And this pattern is present in both mouse and human, pointing to evolutionary preserved function of Wnt5a in the tissue development. Moreover, we also noticed Wnt5a expression being restricted mostly to the distal villi in the branched fourth ventricle choroid plexus, as opposed to the more basal regions. And this points to the possible role of epithelial Wnt5a as a molecular factor underlying the branching of the tissue. So to test this hypothesis, we decided to investigate impact of Wnt5a ablation of the fourth ventricle choroid plexus. And confirming our initial assumptions, we noticed that the loss of Wnt5a leads to impaired morphogenesis of the tissue, that is demonstrated by the reduction in the overall size of the tissue, as well as its intricate branching architecture. And to further explore the role of Wnt5a in this physiological context, we also employed an additional model for specific induction of Wnt5a overexpression. And interestingly, by overexpression of Wnt5a, we noticed that the choroid plexus responds by impaired development, again recapitulating our observation in the full knockout model. Next, given our initial observations, we wanted to decipher whether epithelium is the major source of the Wnt5a and thus contributes to the observed morphological phenotypes in the full knockout and overexpression animal models. And for this purpose, in collaboration with Jan Procházka at BioCEF in Prague, we developed a model for plexus-specific depletion of Wnt5a using a FoxJ promoter, which, as you can see, efficiently drives recombination specific for the choroid plexus. And by using this model, we were able to efficiently deplete Wnt5a in the plexus tissue, and not only in the epithelium, but also in the surrounding stromal region. So, corroborating our previous findings, epithelium-specific abrogation of Wnt5a resulted in a similar hypomorphic developmental phenotype of fourth ventricle plexus. And surprisingly, we also uncovered a temporal component to this Wnt5a mediated regulation, where timing of Wnt5a depletion influenced observed phenotype. So in contrast to the Wnt5a ablation at E11.5, induction of Wnt5a depletion following tamoxifen treatment 24 hours later did not lead to any detectable reduction of the embryonic size or its embryonic plexus size or its morphology. Moreover, we were interested in the activation of different Wnt pathways in this developmental context. And here you can see the analysis of these components between fourth ventricle and lateral ventricle choroid plexus. And upon closer inspection, we noticed that in the fourth ventricle choroid plexus, there is specific activation of non-canonical Wnt components, such as signaling hub protein DCHO2 or membrane protein ROR1. Importantly, Wnt5a depletion led to loss of this non-canonical signaling activation and observed phosphorylations of ROR1 and DCHO2. To our surprise, however, a biochemical analysis of the plexus tissues also reveals stronger activation of canonical signaling specific for the lateral ventricle choroid plexus, demonstrated by the phosphorylation, by the phosphorylation of the LRP6 protein. And this suggests, furthermore, we also noticed that upon Wnt5a ablation, we see a partial phosphorylation of this receptor also in the fourth ventricle choroid plexus. And this result suggests that there might exist a dynamic interplay for Wnt5a signaling in the developing lateral and fourth ventricle choroid plexuses. Next, we wanted to identify the factors that may underlie this spatially specific expression of Wnt5a And one of the interesting candidates was the MACE1 factor that has been previously identified to be enriched in the fourth ventricle choroid plexus as compared to the lateral ventricle choroid plexus. We noticed that the WNT5A segregates to same region within the developing fourth ventricle choroid plexus as MACE1, suggesting a possible interaction. And we confirmed this hypothesis by showing that indeed MACE1 binds directly to WNT5A promoter in the developing fourth ventricle choroid plexus. And to better understand this interaction between MACE1 factor and WNT5A, we employed an adenoviral-based strategy, thanks to the great collaboration, especially with the postdoc from Maria's lab, Ahram. And we used this model for efficient targeting of the embryonic choroid plexuses and for the overexpression of MACE1 in the choroid plexus epithelium. So what happens when you overexpress MACE1 during plexus embryogenesis? We noticed that once we induced MACE1 overexpression in the plexus epithelium, we seen upregulation of WNT5A in the tissue, which led to the also increase at the WNT5A protein levels. Moreover, we also wanted to see the effect of MACE1 ablation on the tissue, and for this we employed another model for plexus-specific removal of MACE1 in the collaboration with our colleagues in Prague. And here you can see that this model indeed leads to efficient MACE removal from the tissue. And as you can see here, MACE1 ablation in the developing plexuses leads to the very efficient reduction in the overall WNT5A levels, and as well to the rich reduction of the size of the tissue. So to sum up, we show that the WNT5A is enriched in the fourth ventricle choroid plexus as compared to the lateral ventricle plexus. We also show that there is a distinct pattern of non-canonical and canonical WNT activation in different plexuses. We also noticed that the WNT5A balance is crucial for the proper development of the tissue. And we also proved that the epithelial WNT5A is the culprit driving this WNT5A specific effect on the plexus development. We also shown that MACE1 is a factor that is again spatially enriched in the fourth ventricle choroid plexus as compared to the lateral ventricle choroid plexus. And it acts as a regulator of WNT5A expression in the embryonic fourth ventricle choroid plexus. And finally, I just want to highlight this interesting difference in the morphology between these two plexuses, which maybe might be partially driven by WNT5A. And finally, I would like to acknowledge all the people who helped me to get to this beautiful result, especially my former students Petra in Vika's lab, also Maria Lektin in lab, especially her talented postdocs Ahram and Neil, and my current group leader Fiona in University of Basel, who allowed me to finish this project, and also many other great collaborators. And with this, I would like to thank you for your attention, and I'm happy to take your questions.
Great. Karol, thanks so much for the beautiful talk. Once again, extremely clear. So I have a first question here from Alex. What is known about choroid plexus evolution? Might it explain the difference in the development between the two plexuses?
Well, it might partially. So what is known is that choroid plexus is present in all the vertebrates, but it has been established that developmentally speaking, the first plexus that has appeared during evolution was the fourth ventricle plexus. And the lateral ventricle plexus was the last one. So also in this transcriptional study that identified MACE1 as an interesting target that is spatially differentially expressed between the lateral and fourth ventricle plexus, it has been shown that these plexuses employ very distinct transcriptional programs. So there probably is a strong evolutionary component that might be underlying these observed differences in the regulation.
Great. I have a general question. Do you see differences sort of in the physiology of the plexus and as a consequence in a change in molecular in the mechanical forces, during development of the embryo that could then impact on the development of other brain regions? I'm thinking of the cortex in particular and how perhaps, you know, the shape of that neural tube would be different because of these mutations.
Hmm.
So, the correlation to mechanical forces and how mechanically, you know, because of the cerebrospinal fluid produced and so on and so forth, and whether you change mechanically the forces at play within this neural tube and as a consequence see problems in specification and development of other brain regions.
So this is really a nice question. So I would first of all say that we have some preliminary findings that were not included in this work that show that when you look into the postnatal stages in the embryos, in the conditional knockout WNT5A embryos for the choroid plexus, you can actually see some craniofacial deformations, which indicate that they might be mediated, for example, by changes in the CSF and in the tension. Also, I would say that in our previous work, where we shown that these WNT5A in the foraminal choroid plexus can be also released into the CSF, when we studied more closely the physiology of the brain or development of the brain upon the plexus-specific WNT5A ablation, we noticed reduction of the developing hindbrain region of the brain, which might be again also partially connected to the overall changes in the CSF and perhaps the tension that the CSF can like generate in the developing brain. But I cannot comment further on this.
Yeah, it's very difficult to distinguish between the chemical and the mechanical of what may be going on there. But I was thinking more sort of a pinching point in the neural tube where, you know, a change in mechanical force could totally change the fate actually of the progenitors as well.